Welcome to Dr. Piercy's Using the Online Java API Documentation. In this video, you'll learn how to find the online Java API documentation, you'll learn how to navigate the online Java API documentation, and you'll review the elements that you can find on the typical Java API documentation page. First, some background information. API stands for Application Program Interface. An API provides a set of routines, protocols, and tools for building software applications. The API specifies how software components should interact and are used when programming graphical user interface components. For Java, the API is the set of classes included with the Java development environment. This is sometimes referred to as the Java Class Library, or JCL. These classes are written using the Java language and run on the Java virtual machine. The Java API includes everything from collection classes to GUI classes. An important concept of object-oriented programming is reusing classes that have already been built. This can be done because people have built a lot of Java classes and put them in the Java API. So when we need to use something that has already been built, such as a string class or a result set class for database connectivity, instead of building it ourselves, we can just grab it from the Java API. Of course, we don't always know all the ins and outs of classes that somebody else has built. And there are a huge amount in the Java API, so it's a good idea to know where we can find the documentation. As of November 2014, when this video is being created, the current version of Java is Java 8. So you can find the API documentation at docs.oracle.com/8/docs/API. As you'll see, this can be difficult to navigate at times, especially if you don't know what type of class you need. So here's a tip. If you know the name of the Java class, simply type Java followed by the class name into Google, and the URL for the Java API page for that class usually appears as one of the top listings. For example, try it using Java space string. That's going to yield the Java API page for the string class as the top listing. Now that we know where to find it, as you can see at the URL at the top of my browser window, let's have a look at what we'll find when we get to the documentation for the Java API. We are currently looking at the Java API on its front page, so to speak, and we're looking at it in what is known as the frames version. We can see three different frames. The larger frame generally is the information we want to be reading. The frame in the upper left corner, notice that's a list of packages, a package being an organized namespace for storing classes that have some kind of relation to one another, and then a list of all the classes in the third frame on this view. As we'll see later, we can also view things with no frames, in which we get the larger frame here as one single page without the other navigation to packages and classes. At the top of the main frame, we do see some various menu options: overview, package, class, use, tree, deprecated, index, and help. Not all of these are active at all times. I'll let you explore other pages on your own, but for this video I want to show you how you might be able to review the information about particular classes of interest for you to use in your Java applications. For instance, let's look at Java String class. The Java String class is located in the java.lang package. So one way we can get there is to browse through the packages, click on java.lang. You notice that the lower left-hand navigation frame has now switched to show us the various interfaces and classes that are within the java.lang package. So I can now move my cursor into that window, and I can scroll until I see string. I'll click on string, and in the main viewing window I can see the page that gives me information for a string. So in summary, to navigate the Java API documentation in the frames version, you simply pick the package in the upper left that you want to find your class. You scroll through the list of classes in that package in the lower left, click on the one you want, and then you'll see the information shown in the larger window. At this point, I want to show you a little bit about what's provided when you look at a particular page in the Java API documentation. I'm going to click on No Frame so that we can see class String as the full page in my browser. Here we see the No Frames look. You'll notice that we still have the menu options at the top and a submenu with Previous Class, Next Class, Frames, No Frames, and All Classes. We can also get summaries by clicking on Field Summary, Constructor Summary, Method Summary, and even Detail, Field Detail, Constructor Detail, and Method Detail. All of those were quick links to various parts of this long page about the class String, and we'll see each of those in turn. Just keep in mind that we can get to some of them quicker by clicking the links at the top. So let's just have a look at what we can see about class String. I chose String because most people who are familiar with at least basic programming in Java have some familiarity with the String class. Near the top, one of the first things we noticed, just above where it says class String, which is the title of the page, we note just above that, that it's in the java.lang package. We can always see which package it is here. Just below the page title class String, we also get kind of a listing of the inheritance tree. In this case, we see that java.lang string inherits from java.lang object. Incidentally, if a class does not inherit directly from some other class in the API, it will always inherit from object. In other words, object is always the top class in any inheritance tree for a Java class. You could say that every class is an object. Just below the inheritance tree, we now see what interfaces that might be implemented by the particular class. In this case, we see serializable, character string, and comparable. So above the line, we get the basic information about the class. Below the line, the first thing we're going to see is the stub for the class signature that you might find if you were to view the code for the class String in a Java editor. We again see that it extends object and implements serializable, comparable, and character sequence or char sequence. The area just below this Java signature will give us some detailed information about how String might be used and could give us some examples of how we could use it. So if you're using the Java API to explore a class for the first time, this is good to read. It might be good to read even if you feel like you know the class, because you might find some surprising information that you didn't know that will help you use that class better. If we scroll down, we can start to see some more information, and just at the bottom of that descriptive area, we see some links to other classes that we might be interested in because they're related to String. The next area we're going to get is what's known as the field summary. Again, this is a summary of fields. We saw it briefly earlier when I clicked on hyperlinks at the top of the page. You might have used String many times and not even known that it has at least one field. The field is listed under the field and description part of this table. The field is called case insensitive order, and we can see that it says it's a comparator that orders string objects as by, compare to, ignore case. You might not know what that means, so you might have to do some more digging even to understand the description, but we do see that there's a field. Under the modifier and type column of this table, we see that it's a static field and that its type is a comparator implemented with String. Many classes will have more fields, and you'll find them all in the field summary table. Next, we have the constructor summary. You might be surprised to realize that String actually has a constructor. Most time we don't even have to call it when we create a string. It's a special class in that way. You might also be surprised that not only does it have one constructor, it has about 10 to 15 constructors. Now, each constructor takes different parameters, as you should when you overload methods, and you can read about each constructor based on its description. One thing I waited to show you here instead of showing with field is that if this is not enough information for you about a particular member of the Java class, you can actually click on the name, in this case the name of the constructor, and it will take you to the more detailed view, which shows up later in the page. It's all part of the same page, so we could scroll to this eventually. Take just a moment as I scroll slowly to look at some of the constructors in string. In the next table, we get a list of the methods for string, and there are a lot. It's very nice that somebody wrote this class for us so that we can use it, and gives us lots of things that we can do with strings. In the center, the main column will show the method name and a description. We can also see here in the method name any parameters that the method requires in order to do its work. For instance, char at requires us to provide an index. We can see by the description that char at returns the char value at the specified index. So if we give it a number, like 2, it's going to take the string and look at the, I think, second letter, and then return that letter to us. Now I think it's second, I'm not sure. We'll find out in a minute. Notice also the first column tells us the modifier and type. This is basically the return type. So we can see, just as we expect from reading the description, that the char at method will return a char data type. We can narrow the method table down by clicking some of the tabs. For instance, if we want to see only static methods, instance methods, concrete methods, or deprecated methods, we can see all of those by clicking on the appropriate tab. As I mentioned, I wasn't sure whether the char at would return the second character if I gave it a 2, or possibly the third. Thinking it could give us the third, it really depends on how it counts the first character using a 1 or a 0. So if I want to know more, I can click on char at, and I can see a bigger description. Public char, char at, int x provides the signature of the actual Java method. The description says it returns the char value at the specified index. An index ranges from 0 to length. So it does start with 0. So the first character is actually at index 0. So if I put a 2 into char at, I'm going to get the third character. That's good to know. Some other things that are given in the details, how it's specified. We see that char at is required by string because we're implementing the interface char sequence. It takes a parameter index, index of the character value we're looking for. It returns a char value at the specified index of the string. We also see that it throws an index out of bound exception. We could scroll down the summary table and look for various methods that might help us with strings. So the next time you want to work on a string using some code, before you reinvent the wheel, have a look at the Java API documentation to see if maybe somebody has already written a method that would be useful for you when working with a string. Well, that concludes our brief tour of the Java API documentation. You should probably give it a try and look at a few pages on your own to get the hang of it, so you can realize the full power of coding with Java. The primary reference for this video is Oracle's Java API site, which you can find at docs.oracle.com/java.se/8/docs/API. This will provide the documentation for the Java API for Java SE version 8. This video was written, narrated, and produced by Dr. Craig A. Piercy. The background music is How About It by Topher Moore and Alex Elena from the YouTube free audio collection. This has been a Piercy production.